Buenas tardes. Good afternoon. I'm very happy to be here, and thank you very much for RISE and for the University of Airfield to invite me to give this talk. I'm very excited to be here. And then also, I want to introduce not only my research, but also the collaborations that I'm having with the RISE team. My name is Chenghe Guan. I'm assistant professor at NYU Shanghai, and also working with Peak Urban. It's an urban research program. A lot of us actually involved in this program. And then today, the research is actually based on a urban simulation project, which also actually derived from the Peak Urban program. So now we can actually focus on the slide. Okay, the topic of today's talk is spatial dynamics of urban simulation and urban big data analytics. The first part is actually urban simulation. As I mentioned early on, this is part of the Peak Urban Research Project. The P actually stands for prediction and projection. This is part of my research. To break it down, there's three parts to the prediction and projection. The first part is spatial dynamics of urban simulation from an interdisciplinary approach. And the second part is urban big data analytics by using urban big data and apply to the context of emergent urbanism. And then third part is actually emerging technology in urban science, all focusing on two subtopics of part one and part two. So this is basically a breakdown of what exactly of this three part of research. And then today I'm going to talk about part 1A, which is the application of cellular automata model, a specific model called sluice model. And also I'm going to introduce a little bit about Marco Chen MCA model, and then the CNN, which is a convolutional neural network model, and how they can be applied into the geospatial modeling. And then I marked with a red color text, migration policy. That's also something that I have in mind. I want to put into this research. And part two is urban big data. I'm going to introduce a research related to neighborhood, but it's actually focusing on the planning of urban green system using cell phone data. A little bit of background knowledge, envision the future of cities. I don't know if actually people recognize any of the slides here. The one on the top left, which one?
Garden City.
Garden City, exactly. Garden City is from 1902. Yeah, that's actually, if not the earliest, but one of the origin of, you know, talking about what our future city should be look like. And it's also introduced a concept of a polycentric urban structure from a monocentric urban structure. And then the image next to it is actually a image drawn by a very famous architect called Frank Lloyd Wright in 1930s in the United States. So he was proposing this concept called broad acre city. Everyone owns their own lands, and then, you know, this is the future of the city. We are all living in harmony. And then comes the time of modernism, which is the lower left image. Look, exactly. So we have some audience here actually know the content of the future city studies. So during this time period, people start to focusing on the efficiency or the efficacy of city, how we can make city function faster, better, and then we can increase accessibility. Then by the 1960s, a French geographer visited the northeastern part of the United States, which is this image. And then he started to talk about a concept called a megalopolis. This actually gave rise to our study or our research of urban simulation today. We are focusing on regional urbanization or even global urbanization. So this is a very, very quick background of the urban simulation research. And then let's get into the more technical part of urban simulation. The cellular automata model was actually invented before the World War II. And then the concept has been applied to urban growth simulation in the 1970s, including Michael Betty, including a lot of very renowned researchers in this field. And a lot of them actually today, they start to get involved with urban big data. The three pros of cellular automata, including accountable algorithm. So the algorithm is actually very easy to understand and very easy to control. You can actually include urban policies into this algorithm. So actually I had a conversation with Hilo last week. We were actually summarizing the difference between cellular automata model and the machine learning model. So this is one of the top concepts. The second is simplicity. It has a very few coefficients. Of course, you can add on more coefficient as you wish, but the very basic one only include you know, the slope and then traffic, existing urban area, and so forth. And then, you know, in contrast with the Lowry model and other backward prediction model, this is a forward projection. But it doesn't require a population projection. It can be included, but the very basic standard model doesn't include the population model, which is actually required for the machine learning model, as Hilo and his team is working on. So get into more specifics, accountable algorithm. So it's basically a concept of neighborhood. Think about there's one dimension and two dimension. The one dimension is to the left, where you have just one line. You only have x. And then the right one is x and y. So if you have a cell, this cell, at time t, and then it will affect the cell next to it, it can affect one or two, the cell next to it. So at the time t plus one, the neighboring cell will have an opportunity to become urban. So in a more computer, you know, based language, zero or one, you know, it's this is one and all the a blank is zero, and then your neighbor has a higher chance to become one. So it's the same concept when we're looking at this two-dimensional cellular automata neighborhood model. We have the Moore neighborhood and then the von Neumann neighborhood. Some people call it the Queen's neighborhood. Depending on the definition, one cell can have eight neighbor or four neighbor, depending on how do you count the neighbor. And then this relationship can be expanded to the second neighborhood or even the third neighborhood. That can also be based on a formula that we can put into, or matrix we put into the model. And then this is some of the quick illustrations of growth coefficients. And there's spontaneous growth. Just think about, you know, there's some urban area emerged. What used to be a small town or a small rural area become an urban area. And then larger cities become larger. That's the spreading coefficient. And there's also the edge growth. You know, I don't know if you guys are familiar with the edge city growth. It's also a phenomenon happening in the United States. The city actually leap forward and to grow in the edge area. So the edge become actually the new city center. So this is another concept of this. And of course, the road influence. Accessibility is a very important part of modern cities. Forward projection, you know, can be involved in into population projections and then other type of urbanization projections. So the calibration process, I won't get into the technical part of calibration. The calibration basically involves three or four different steps, from the very coarse calibration to the very fine calibrations. But during this process, this is actually an example I use for the Yangtze River Delta in China. So what we need to know is what are the important events that affect the urbanization process. For example, in China, the study area I was looking at, in the 1970s or late 1960s, this a special policy that sent all these youngsters to the countryside. So, you know, instead of urbanization goes up and up, there's a dip that people being sent away from the cities. So we have to consider those kind of events in order to calibrate our model. So this is a model structure. Basically, I introduced the cellular automata model, and then some of the coefficient is called the sluice model. The sluice model was actually invented also in the United States. And then combining these two models, we actually call this a scenario-based cellular automata model. There's very many different variations of cellular automata model, but they're all based on the same principle. And then this is a quick illustration of how to solve a policy question into a mathematical question by having this. We call this, this is also based on a discussion I had with ILO. We call this either a closed loop or it's an open loop question. The model structure, also using the Yangtze River Delta as an example, is two sides. On the left-hand side is the baseline model. You have a baseline, so you can compare the policy intervention, the effect of policy intervention. On the right-hand side is actually the policy. And then we actually compare the baseline with the scenarios. You can come up with more than four, or you can come up with less than four scenarios. And then we make a new matrix to compare the baseline versus the scenarios. This is one quick example. We predicted, we are using a calibration model from 1970s to 2010, and then we dropped the 1970s data. So we only using 1990 data to start with. And then we predicted from 2011 to 2030. So this is the year by year predictions. One of the results we are looking at is based on certain type of policy. For example, the bigger city will grow bigger, which means you constrain the growth of smaller city, but you push older people to go to larger cities. I'll explain later why this actually can be effective. But based on that policy, the prediction model tells us the conventional wisdom of the Yangtze River Delta is this become a one big region, but the model. Our prediction model actually shows instead of one big chunk, the cities become a sub-regional kind of a mega city type of urban growth. So this huge area get divided into four parts. So this is the Shanghai area. I think most people know this is one of the mega cities or global cities in China. And then in the Jiangsu province, there's two big areas. So this is the Wuxi and Suzhou, and also including Changzhou. So those are the three cities, smaller cities than Shanghai, but they form their own urban cluster. And then in Nanjing, which is the capital city of the province, it actually forms a shape of a banana. So people actually compare with this more economical concept of the blue banana in the European context, but this is a very different scale. And on the other side, on the north side of Shanghai, there's the Hangzhou area. It also forms its own urban cluster. So we may argue that instead of megalopolis, we can have this kind of city region or sub-regional urban clusters. And that might be a possible solution, a possible policy intervention for China's future growth. So this, if you guys are interested, this paper has been published in Urban Planning, Environment and Urban Planning Part B, Urban Analytics and City Science. So this is a very quick review of the example of Yangtze River Delta, using this example to understand cellular automata model and sluice model. And now I want to talk about how to apply not only the cellular automata model, but apply urban growth model in general to understand our city, to create this genre of city science. So I listed A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. So there's eight part of this, and I'll go through them little by little. So this is actually a work also derived from the peak urban research. Michael Keith is also actually involved in this, and I'm hoping the IAFID team can also get involved in this research. So the first one is urban sprawl. As you guys know, in the 1970s, as I showed the context, there's different phenomena happening, megalopolis. The reason why it's important to use cellular automata to understand urban future is because urban sprawl. That's the very phenomenon happened in the United States in the 1970s, and that the building of highways, the people getting lower mortgage. Okay, so the first part is urban sprawl. The very reason that we have this urban simulation. This kind of urban future study is because in the 1970s, we had urban sprawl. That's a phenomenon that emerged in the United States. You know, all this construction of highways, low mortgage, and then people coming back, the veterans, and you know, they need a place to live. So this is an opportunity where urbanization in United States happens to be urban sprawl type of growth. And that's why we start to actually using the urban growth model to understand the phenomenon. This is actually something not related to urbanization directly, but it actually tells us, you know, what are the future projection could be. You know, this is using the universe as an example. You know, we can project our research area to become a smaller and smaller. You know, people are talking about shrinking cities. We can say, you know, this is our study area. So the administrative boundary is not going to change. We can also talk about, no, this area is actually going to change, but in a way that has a linear relationship with the growth of population, you know, growth of population and land urbanization. There can be also a acceleration of the growth boundary, which is kind of a exponential growth of urbanization. So what it is is a population, is land. I can explain a little bit later, but this is something we need to understand in order to understand urban sprawl. So these are the three laws. I call this the urban law of urban science. We don't really teach this in school, but I actually teach my student to understand these three laws and using these three laws to understand city. And we're actually trying to write a book about the laws of cities and then trying to connect this with the urban simulation process. The first law is frequency law. This is actually a very important law. I think at some point Raphael actually presented on this law. It's about Zipf's law. It's also about the distribution of cities, rank size, even though we don't really understand exactly why it happened. It's actually a phenomenon. We can trace the size of city by using this. Also the concept of a primary city and then the concept of the Pareto distribution. The second law is we call the proportion law or the allometric law. So think about as city grow, there's certain things grow together with city, but there are other things grow at a different rate as the city grow. For example, if a city grow, the size of city expanded twice, for example, the population very likely will grow exponentially. So the city grow twice the size, the population grow because of the density also grow. So that's an exponential relationship. And there's also some things that grow slower than the city. You guys can think about that. So the example I'm always using is infrastructure. So if you adding, say, 1% of population to the city, you don't need to build another 1% of infrastructure to provide service for this population. So the infrastructure are sunk cost, but it also grows less faster than the city. There are certain things grow the same speed as city. So, you know, I wouldn't put much examples, but you can think about, you know, sometimes people are saying, you know, wage will grow even faster. So the bigger city you go, the higher chances you can earn more money. So that's the basic idea. And then the gravity law. The gravity law can be interpreted in many ways. You know, there's accessibilities, connectivities, China building this high-speed rail. The world are connected because of the airplane, the cheap price, you know, the connectivity, the frequency. Also, there's people talking about global urbanization or planet urbanization. Neil Brenner was from GSU, Harvard University. And there's also more specific concept related to this TOD, transit-oriented development. When you put a train station, you know, the growth will actually be attracted in that area. So that's the formation of urban clusters. So if you're interested in these three laws, we can talk more about that. Each of these laws can be, you know, a very interesting topic for a PhD thesis or multiple PhD theses. And then the second is zoning and land use regulations. So I have no knowledge about zoning here in Colombia, but zoning was actually very, very important in the early age American cities, Chicago, because of big fire, that's, you know, the whole zoning law started to come into play, and then a lot of zoning laws was actually experimented in New York City. Just one quick example, it's also related to the research model I mentioned early on, using Young's Real Delta. The upper two images is the different policy intervention create different scenarios of urban growth. The red one shows where these kind of ecological high value area get urbanized. And the lower one is actually a city in the west coast of the United States, Portland, Oregon. So this is a city where they use very small, fine-grained urban grid to create a city. They also implement a law basically called the urban growth boundary. The boundary, basically, if you look at this, inside the boundary, you can grow as you wish, but outside the boundary, there's no infrastructure, you can't really grow. I'm not saying this is the best solution, but it also it provides one of the solutions, but it also creates these inequalities. If you own a land here, your land price is going to increase, but if you happens to own a land across the street, then basically you don't really catch all the values. The third part is the migration policies. So this is a project that we start to investigate it. There's a very famous project called the Three Gorges Dam Project. So this is one of the largest hydration project hydration power to support electricity of the surrounding area. The consequence of the Three Gorges Dam is this is the area where it happens. There are over 2 million people get relocated. They are either relocated to a higher ground because there's 175 meters of height was inundated because of the creation of this dam. There's also people being relocated to other areas. And then you can see in the 1999 is the year where most of the people, there's a big dip, most of the people being relocated away. And then later on, people are coming back or people are relocating from the rural area to the city. So this is, you can see a huge influence of this regional policy or national policy. So what we are interested in is to look at the towns that are affected by this kind of migration policy. Also the electricity related hydropower policy. So from 1984, this is just a small town. This is the Yangtze River. This is the largest river in China. And then by 1995, you can see people start to build new towns. That actually right before the Three Gorges Dam happened. By 2003, you can see the old town was completely underwater. It's no more. It's just no more existence. And people are relocated to these two locations. But one location start to die, and the other location start to grow exponentially. So we're trying to understand what makes this happen. Is it because of the economic activities? Because of the highway goes through one town, not the other? Or is it because of the social capital that one town created attract more people to go there instead of going to the other ones? And then just for your information, this town are very close to a very famous tourist center. So at the beginning of this project, people are dying to go to this town instead of the other one, because they think they're going to survive, they're going to have a better life in the other town, but it's the other way around. So this is the old image of this town, and then we don't see it anymore, and then this is the new towns being created. So this is also an image we showed at the presentation at the end of our site visit. We are seeing, there's a lot of similarities between Chongqing and Medellin. So in a way, vertical accessibility is very, very important. So this is the image shows, people will line up waiting for the elevator to go up so they don't have to spend 40 minutes to get up here. So now they can use this kind of vertical infrastructure, and very similar to the cable cars in Medellin, staircase in Comuna Tales, it's a very interesting comparison. And then some of this project, we can see this is before the construction. You know, this is not, it's a very steep slope, and it's not very easy to build upon. But afterward, you know, this is what happens. So in the context of United States and context of China, a lot of time the developers get blamed for being the money maker, for being, you know, deprived of people's benefit. But this is a very different story. People here, they love the developer. They're saying, you know, that this we gave this developer a piece of land like this, and then he brought us a new town, has a lot of vertical accessibility, make our life much, much easier. So this is something we need to understand. But of course, there are other consequences of being built in this kind of, I would say, ecological vulnerable area. So the next one we are interested to understand is, you know, watershed management, and also related to the hydrological process. So this is one of the models we are trying to look at. Also, this is also the Yangtze River Delta area, but we actually expand the area into a larger area. It's a kind of a sub-national study area. We are looking at the hydrological exchange process and how that affects the urban growth process. Basically, this is an image we borrowed from other studies. Basically, we're trying to understand that the precipitation and the evaporation process. We're not interested in what happens here, precipitation over ocean. We're only interested in the terrestrial precipitation. You know, there's precipitation and there's evaporation and there's transpiration. We are trying to understand how evaporation and transpiration affect city. So when you don't have city, the surface are covered by vegetations, so it has certain, you know, transfer evaporation process. But in the city, most of the people will think about once you have the city and then you slow down the transfer evaporation process. But it's not that a simple process. Sometimes it actually will help the vegetations to provide a stronger possibility to conduct the transpiration process. So that's what we are studying right now. We are trying to understand the rate of transpiration. You know, it's not the average of the year, but it actually changes monthly throughout the year. And then we also need to consider the surface temperature as well as the accumulated precipitations. So this is some of the surface change that we are looking at for the evaporation process. So that's a quick thought. You know, we have introduced many of these urban growth related topics. We need to think about prevention and adaptation and how urban simulation process can help to answer or review the process of climate change. I rarely use global warming because it's not really about global warming, it's about climate change. A lot of places, the temperature is actually slowing down. It's depending on a lot of other issues as well. And the next one is actually landscape and ecological sustainability of urban growth. So basically, we're trying to understand if we have a model, we can understand land, we can understand water, we can understand energy, how we can combine those three together, so which is actually a nexus model. So it's not really, you know, urban land growth and then affect the water area and then we can produce energy to support urbanization. It's actually intertwined. It's very, if you guys actually run regression models, it's similar to the structural equation model. You can find the causality relationship. You can also put the independent model into the, you can also put the dependent model into the independent model. Basically, some of the dependent variables also cause indirectly or directly the consequence of urbanization. And then next one is about comparative analysis of urban dynamics. We actually reviewed over 100 papers, but there are very, very few papers talking about comparative analysis. So I think this is one of the research gap is also one of the advantages that we can take as, you know, a research group, a multinational research group. We can actually address this comparative analysis. This comparative analysis has two meanings. One is to compare different regions. The other is to actually compare the region itself, compare the subregions within the region. So we are actually looking at the Marmara Sea area. We are able to actually get some of the urban growth historical data in, of this region. And now we pick this area because this is an area has a lot of contrast. You know, this is Istanbul. On the east part, on the west part is actually Europe. On the east part is Asia. So it has a lot of political, administrative, cultural difference. And the area was actually divided into four parts. One is the mega city of Istanbul, how this city grew. And then one is the European side. And on the Asian side, it also has one and two parts. They are under very different political or administrative policies. So we are trying to understand if these four regions grow separately versus the four regions can grow in a more balanced way under the same administration, what will happen? This is some of the very preliminary tests we are running. We haven't really finished this investigation. And we also used the MCA model to run this. And then this is the MCA, the multiple correspondent analysis. Also, we use cluster analysis to understand this. And then the methodology part. Methodology part is actually very much related to machine learning and artificial intelligence. So this is some of the criticism of cellular automata. It's overfitting, because actually, basically, a human being can become better. A human being can, you know, manipulate the coefficients. This is also a discussion I had with Hilo, and Hilo was saying, you know, you train the machine get better. And I was saying, you run the cellular automata model, the person who run the model get better. The model itself doesn't change. And then the coefficient selection has also bias. Predetermined shape matrix would decide, you know, the appropriate Monte Carlo runnings or what are the results, because each of the results are different. Every time you run, it's different. So now we started looking at neural networks and machine learning models. I'm sure Hilo has more understanding than I than this. So this is a basic neuron. And then people start to put a neural network and cellular automata together. Combining those two to predict urban future. So this is one of the research I'm working with, one of my research assistants and a undergraduate student to actually apply neural network or machine learning method to actually incorporate cellular automata coefficient into the neural network. This is some of the very basic concept. I'll go really quick. And then this is a convolutionary neural network. This is a model that we want to apply. We actually started by talking about study Medellin, but now we choose two different cities, and then we found the corresponding cities in China as well. I think one city is Montenegro. Right, yeah. And then we picked two cities in the Zhejiang province of China, because one has a similar terrain of like a flat area, one is more mountainous, hilly area. Also, we are talking about other ways to improve the prediction model. So one of this is actually to use the ordinary differential equation model to have a growth sequence, a continuous growth sequence instead of year by year, instead of setting up this year by that year. You know, this can or may or may not affect substantially of our results. And also, we are actually talking about branching theory. This is another theory we are trying to introduce to understand not only the urban growth models, but understand some of the basic concept of urban loss that I mentioned early on. And also, we need to think about other factors affecting our city. You know, the emergence of electrical vehicles, autonomous vehicles. How does this going to change our city, the infrastructures, and then how can we reflect that in our future urban simulation and urban growth modelings? You know, some very basic examples, if all the cars are autonomous vehicles, we probably don't need the street as wide as we have right now, and then maybe it will affect the very factors of transit-oriented development. It also will change people's concept of commuting longer hours. You know, people can actually work in their car. So we'll definitely create different compactness, diversity, connectivities, or urban intensities in the future city. And now we're also looking at energy support, and then this new ways how the transition from coal plant to natural gas. And then we are also looking at other big data. For example, you know, we are trying to understand people's behavior, individual people's behavior through, you know, Twitters, through, this is a kind of Uber, basically it's the Chinese version of Uber, and also shared bikes and other available models. So this is actually a very quick summary of where we at for the urban growth modeling. So the second part of the research is actually applying urban big data. The example I use is mobile phone data, but as I think Jorge mentioned early on, there's other opportunities we can combine this individual data, which is actually really a benefit we have as researchers in this decade, in the previous decade. 10 years ago, before I started my PhD, we don't have this kind of data. So basically, it's re-evaluate urban system using urban big data, because this is really a personal behavior data, and then rethink the concept of urban neighborhood. I'll go through this really quick, different type of ways to measure distance, Euclidean distance, network distance, real-time distance. And the concept of neighborhood was derived from a Euclidean distance-based concept in the 1920s. And then we are using this as a way to actually understand transportation by using time distance. And then now we are trying to understand the real-time behavior of human beings. So this is a paper actually on computer environment and urban system. This is one I think you guys are trying to do a special issue on, right? So this is basically using the mobile phone data. The nature of this project is to actually use a 1 year cell phone data, record people's locations every 5 minutes, so we can have a very precise location of when people visit certain urban facilities. We choose urban parks. So these are the parks we selected in Tokyo metropolitan area. And then this shows where the parks, the location of the parks. And we compile the data, because I mentioned, you know, it's 5 minutes per location, so it's a lot of data. And there's 1 million samples in this data set. So we divided parks into different scales: neighborhood park, district park, national park, and scenery park. And then this is basically a service area, or we call the park catchment area. So if we have a policy, say in Japan, a neighborhood park will cover a radius of 400 to 500 meters. So this is basically a circular area. So you can see actually, at this scale, at the city scale, it has a lot of circular shapes. So it's basically, you know, the actual usage of the park matches the planning policy regulations. And as we go up to from, you know, the neighborhood to district, sub-district to district to, you know, regional parks, this start to change. So contribution of this paper is just, you know, we start to understand that for smaller parks, the regulations matches the usage, but for larger parks, we need to understand a lot more things: land use, transportation, facilities inside the park to understand the actual park usage, and how to divide the limited resources to these parks. And as we go bigger, it's changed dramatically. You know, as we go to the subnational and national parks. So this is national parks. People are from everywhere from the nation. So there's no way to say, you know, this is the radius, because there's a lot of locational diversity, meaning the mean travel distance doesn't really reflect the actual usage. And then the standard deviation is very, very high, right? So if you have, say, if you have people from Cali come to use a park in this area, will be the outlier, will be, will actually make the standard deviation really high. And we start to look at, different patterns. You know, we actually see a lot of concentric circles. We also see linear expansions. This could be, land and stuff. This could be the macro system affect how it changes. And then there's also irregular shapes can be explained. And then we're actually looking at a much larger scale, the macro scale, metropolitan scale. And it actually changes the way how the policy should be implemented. And then we use actually density to understand this park catchment area. So we are saying we shouldn't say 400 meters or 500 meters. We should say density threshold. So for 200 meters, this density threshold should be smaller and then should be higher. And then as the distance goes further, the density threshold should change. So actually using density distance decayed functions, which is actually a very classical German economic theory to understand this. And then this is different the categories of the parks. And then this actually shows the exact relationship of density and distance decay. And from this density distance decay, we can observe different things. So one thing is we can see this doesn't really follow a linear relationship. Where the drop happens, and where the same distance has a very different density threshold, these are the things that are critical. This is actually making the concentric circle start to change shapes. And ongoing research, so one thing is actually to use weighted population. So now, right now we didn't weight the total population, even though we have 1% of the samples. And also the duration to stay in the park, which is also very, very important. It's not only I use the park for 5 minutes and you highly use for 2 hours. That will have different impact of park usage. And then this is the park, and then we can see the park usage doesn't follow a distance decay function, right? You can see this is green is 30 minutes, and then this is like over 90 minutes. This is really a jigsaw puzzle. And then we are looking at, so this one we're looking at one of the park, and then this we're looking at a different park. But this park start to show certain patterns in the northeastern pattern. So this is from Tokyo. This is actually going to the Chiba Prefecture. And you can see people from this area spend substantially a smaller amount of time in this park. So one of the possibilities is people are actually traveling from Chiba Prefecture to Tokyo to commute to work. And then they may just, passing by the parks. So that's why we start to eliminate all the people who spend less than five minutes in the parks. And then the seasonal variation. So I mean to show this, one by one, but now it all shows up. So the question I want you guys to think about is, which month should be the peak usage of the park? Right? Should it follow the climate? The best season should be April or March, or April or May. This is the best season. So, but right now you can see actually January and February has fewer people using, and then you can actually see April and May has more people using it. And then what about from July to December? Would this also follow that pattern? So this is a very simple assumption that climate or the weather or the precipitation, raining, decided everything. But in a way it follows that, but it also has other factors. One factor is the social events. So in Tokyo, there's a cherry blossom, which happens actually in April. It matches, reinforces the good weather. And then there's also other events in October or December. It also changes the way how people use that. And in addition, we are actually looking at other factors. So during this year, in March, there's a big earthquake. So this is when it affects a lot of people. But it doesn't really change a lot of the pattern. It still have a lot of people using the park compared with February. So in a way, we are saying for this park, the usage really not affected by natural events. And then this is basically trying to understand the different spatial parameters of the park usage. We are using not only area or parameter, also we are using other kind of index to understand the park usage. Also, we are trying to understand how people use the park differently during the weekend versus during the weekend. So these are, this is a very typical transportation study. You know, they differentiate work trip versus non-work trips. So we think this is important. So this is one example. You know, you can see the obvious difference of the weekend and weekday usages. And some theoretical significance and future plans we are thinking about. One is related to urban ecology, which is Professor Richard Foreman. You know, his concept about, you know, movement between two places. You know, this is, you know, famous forest run. So where you can have bigger, smaller parks, and how the spatial distribution of the parks will affect the usage of the parks as a network, not only as individual stuff. So these are some, this Docomo, Docomo is the cell phone carrier we use for Japan. So this is the one we collaborate with. And now we are thinking of getting China data. The PKU team have the China data, but we haven't really get the data yet. So this is some of the transaction data we're trying to understand. It's not only people use the park or use certain facilities, it's how the economic activities also embedded into this kind of activities. So for this study, we may not use park, we may use a different urban infrastructure, a shopping mall or a train station. And that's it. So, yeah. Thank you.